Welcome to the second lecture on pointer analysis. In this lecture, we want to look at flow insensitive points to analysis. Recall that flow insensitive points to analysis says that I'm not going to make any distinction between the information at different program points. I will not consider each control flow point as a separate point at which the information needs to be computed. It is insensitive to the flow, control flow of the program. Here we are going to look at two methods. The first method is Anderson's method called inclusion-based method. And the second method is called the equality-based method, which is Steen's-Gauss approach. And we will see why they are called inclusion and equality-based. Later we will see flow-sensitive pointer analysis, in which we will talk about knee points to analysis and must points to analysis. The assumption in flow insensitive analysis, as we saw just now, is that statements can be executed in any order. When we say that we're not going to maintain different information at each control flow point separately, what that means is that we will have to account for the effect of any statement on any other statement. And therefore, the underlying assumption is that the statements can be executed in any which order. Now, this certainly is very funny because we are ignoring the flow of control. So, if there is statement 1, 2, 3, 4, we are not necessarily assuming that 2 is executed after 1 and 3 is executed after 2. We might as well assume that 3 is first executed, then 1 is executed, then 2 is executed. Or for that matter, 3 is first executed and then 2 is executed and then 1 is executed. So, as I said just now, instead of computing point-specific information, a summary data flow information is computed, and the most important requirement is that the summary information is required to be a safe approximation of the point-specific information at each point. So, if you recall our formal definition of flow insensitive points to analysis, it was defined as a superset of the MOP of flow sensitive knee points to analysis, the union of the information computed by flow sensitive points to analysis at each program point. So when we say the statements can be executed in any order, the control flow graph is a complete graph. There is an edge from any statement to every other statement, except for the start and end nodes. So, why do we need flow insensitive analysis? Does it really make sense? Does it make sense to assume that the statements can be executed in any order? So, it turns out that there are analyses that are very useful and which are flow insensitive analysis. And one analysis that all of you are aware of, although you may not have seen the methods of performing that analysis, is type checking or type inferencing. When we talk about types in, let's say, C or C++ language, the type of a variable is fixed throughout the language. There are functional languages that require the type of a variable to be fixed in a given scope, and the types are inferred. In C, C++, it's a little easier because types are specified. At the same time, types need to be checked. So at every statement, we need to find out whether a variable is being used along with the operator which is allowed, along with an operator which is allowed for the type with which the variable was declared. This checking for each statement can be done in any order. Here, this is less funny because the conclusion that we draw for one statement does not influence the conclusion that we draw for other statement. But in points to analysis, it does. Also, there's something called address taken analysis, where we simply want to know which variables have their addresses taken. This is because a compiler's view of variables is something like this. Local variables are treated as registers, and global variables are treated as memory. So by memory, we say that there is a memory slot, there's a memory location created for those variables, and every time we need to load the variable from that memory, and then we might want to store that variable in the memory if the value is modified. It turns out that the local variables do not need a memory because the scope of the local variables is restricted to a procedure. They cannot be modified by any procedure that is called within this procedure. The only exception to this are the variables whose addresses are taken into a pointer, because a pointer may be passed as a parameter and a variable may be modified separately. So therefore, address taken variables also have to be treated as memory or as global variables. All global variables are like memory. So address taken variables are treated like global variables. No assumption can be made about the address taken variables, about the non-modification of address taken variables across a function call. Now, figuring out these address taken variables is also a flow insensitive analysis. The order of statements really does not matter. There's something called side effects analysis. Does a procedure modify a global variable? Does a procedure modify a reference parameter? All these questions can be answered through flow insensitive analysis. So flow insensitive analysis isn't as unusual as it might seem to be, although in this course we have been doing flow sensitive analysis. So here is a naive algorithm for flow insensitive analysis. Observe how the algorithm works. There is a global information, there is a global repository of information. There is no information associated with each program point. And we assume that the initial value is stop, and then like a round robin algorithm, we set change equal to true and we iterate over all nodes. It need not be in a fixed order, it may be in any order, but for simplicity we have shown here in a fixed order. So within the while loop we say change is false, and then for j equal to 1 to n minus 1, we now compute a temporary value, which is the meat of the global info that we have computed, and the information obtained by applying the flow function of node j to this global information. Note that we have no notion of in of j and out of j. The flow function is applied to the entire global repository of the information, and not, there is no separate information coming to in. And when we apply this, then we merge it with info. It's possible that this may be a subset of info. This may be weaker, this may be stronger than info, in which case in the temp may not be different from info. So we check, is the temporary value that we have computed, is it different from info? If yes, then we need to update the info. Then we say info is equal to temp, and then we say there is a change, and then this ensures that there will be one more pass through this while loop, or one more pass through this particular entire for loop. So this is a naive algorithm to show how flow insensitive analysis can be performed. The traversal often is not on the control flow graph because only the relevant nodes are visited. In practice, flow insensitive analysis is not performed like this. In practice, what is done is constraints imposed by relevant statements are collected in a global repository in one pass, and then in the second pass they are solved independently to compute the least fixed point solution of the constraints. So that's how practically flow insensitive analysis is performed. And because we're not storing information at each program point, we need to store less data, and we have to worry only about the relevant statements. We don't have to worry about the control flow, and therefore flow insensitive algorithms are often faster than the flow sensitive variants. So in order to understand Anderson's and Steensgaard's points to analysis, let's look at the notation that we will use. So we use P with a subscript x dot f, which denotes the set of pointees of structure X along the pointer field F. The assumption is that F is a pointer field, otherwise PXF does not make sense. So we can write the pointage of a pointer X, where X is not a structure, as PX dot star, which we can concisely write as PX to denote the set of pointees of X. We should just ignore this. If X is a structure, PX is a set of pointees of all pointer fields. This line, please ignore it. I should be deleting this, and in the slides I will modify it. Unify X comma Y unifies location X and Y. What does that unification mean? It says that I'm treating X and Y, and here X and Y are pointers, saying I'm treating them as equivalent. X and Y are treated as equivalent locations. What does that mean? It means that the pointees of unified locations are also unified transitively, which means that we are going to say add pointees of X to the pointee set of Y, and add pointee set of Y, add pointees of Y to the pointee set of X, and then unify all pointees of X and Y. Unify PTS XY says that I'm not going to unify X and Y, but I'm going to unify the pointees of X and Y. X and Y themselves are not unified. Okay. We use X dot F if the pointees of field F of X are to be unified. So let's try to look at the Anderson's and Steensberg's algorithm. This algorithm is just a set of constraints, and we have to find out the least fixed point solution of this set of constraints for each statement. And for simplicity, we have not shown a field reference, but in the examples we will see how the constraints are used for that. Here we have shown the four basic pointer assignment statements: X is equal to and Y, X is equal to Y, X is equal to star Y, and star X equal to Y. And now what we will do is we will look at the constraints for each kind of statement imposed by Anderson's pointer analysis and Steensberg's pointer analysis on the points to set that are to be computed. So let's begin by the first statement. Let's assume that the points to graph before the assignment looks like this. X points to a pointee chain PQR, Y points to a pointee chain ABC, and we will use this particular input before each assignment statement to understand the effect of this assignment statement. So what Anderson's points to analysis says is that PX pointee set of X should be a superset of Y, which means that add Y to the pointee set of X. Whatever X was pointing to, Y must be included in that pointee set. Note that this is different from what we would expect in a flow sensitive points to analysis. This assignment, actual effect of this assignment, erases the previous pointees of X. It overwrites the previous pointees of X, is going to write a new value into the location X, and therefore in a flow sensitive points to analysis we will have the pointee set of X as just Y. Here the previous pointees are not removed, previous pointees are retained. We are simply saying that we are adding Y to the pointee set of X, and the reason why this is done is that we are not assuming a certain control flow. For all you know, this statement may be executed before the point, before the statements that provided the point, other pointees of X. That's the assumption. I'm not saying that during the execution that's going to happen. But the whole point is that this statement may be executed before, may be assumed to be executed before some other statement. Because we are not imposing an order, we cannot say remove the previous pointees. In particular, we cannot remove the previous pointees unless we start imposing a control flow order, which is something which is not done in flow insensitive points to analysis. So this is what Anderson's points to analysis says. Let's look at what Steensberg's points to analysis says. Steensberg's points to analysis says, like Anderson, I would like to add Y to the pointee set of X. But going forward, it says that I would like to unify y with every pointee of x, meaning I am assuming that x has a single pointee. If x has multiple pointees, then all of them must be unified. They cannot be treated as distinct. So that's the Steenbergs points to set. So what happens to our graph? So Anderson's graph after the pointer assignment looks like this. We said y should be included in the pointee set of x. So we have an edge from x to p and we have an edge from x to y. This is inclusion based algorithm because y is included in the pointee set of x. What is Steenbergs graph? The Steenbergs graph says it will create Anderson's graph. Because it is first assignment, it would create Anderson's graph and then say that I want to say that x points to a single location. I can insist that by unifying y and p. So y and p are treated as equivalent locations. So we get this graph with a single node in which we have unified y and p. And the unification then says that Q and A must be unified because P and Y have been unified. So we have Q and A unified and we have R and B unified and we have C. So this is the graph obtained by Steenbergs method after the assignment. What happens in the next assignment is just a small variation of this picture. Now we have X is equal to Y. So when we have x is equal to y, what Anderson says is that please include all pointees of y into the pointees of x. The pointee set of y remains unmodified. The pointee set of x is not erased, although in a flow sensitive analysis, we would like to remove the previous pointees of x. Here, we are simply enlarging the pointee set of x sufficiently enough to include all pointees of y. Anderson's wisdom says something else. Anderson's wisdom says unify points to set of x and y. This is similar to adding pointees of y to x and adding pointees of x to y. So effectively, this is seen as a bidirectional assignment. For as far as points to information is concerned, this is seen as an assignment x equal to y and at the same time parallelly I'm doing y equal to x and I'm treating them as equivalent. In normal case, x is erased and made equal to y. There is no change in y, but here when we say we treat them as equivalent, the previous pointees of x are also included in the pointees of y by unifying them. How does our points to graph change because of this assignment? So now we are saying that the pointees of y, which is A, must be included in pointees of x. So this is how the graph looks after Anderson's assignment. Please note again this is inclusion because the previous pointees remain same, nothing is modified, we are just including additional pointees. What would Steenbergs algorithm do? Steenbergs algorithm says unify pointee sets of x and y. The pointee of x is p and the pointee of y is a. So we will unify p and a. And we have, note that x and y themselves are not unified. So we have p and a unified, we have q and b unified, and we have r and c unified. For the previous case, we had P and Y unified. When I say previous case, I am referring to this particular assignment. We had P and Y unified. So this is the graph obtained after the assignment by Steenbergs algorithm. Note that this is equality. We are establishing equality between the pointees of X and Y. The next statement, as we can imagine, is just a small variation of the previous statement. In the next statement, we are saying here in the previous statement x equal to y, we were saying add the pointy set of y to x. Now here we are saying add the pointy set of the pointies of y to the pointy set of x. That's all that we are doing. And here again we are saying instead of unifying x and y, unify the pointies of y with x. And therefore this looks, the graph after Anderson's algorithm looks like this. So we say for all z in pointy set of y, so this is pointy set of y contains a, so z is a here, and now we are saying all pointies of a must be included in the pointies of x. All pointies of a must be included in pointies of x, and therefore we will have an edge from x to b and x to p. Again, this is inclusion. What Steen's Gauss algorithm would do is it would say I want to unify the pointies of x and the pointies of z. In this case, pointy z is a. So therefore p and b will now be unified, and the graph that we get looks like this. X, y points to a, and x and a point to the unification of p and b. Because p and b is unified, therefore q and c are also unified, and then we have r pointed to by this unified node. The effect of the fourth assignment is consistent with what we have been doing. What we are here in this assignment, we are saying add pointies of y to x. Now we are saying add pointies of y to every pointy of x instead of adding it to x. So pick up the pointies of x and add pointies of y to it. Similarly here, unlike unify points to set of x and z, Steen's Gauss algorithm says unify y with every pointy z of x. And the points to set after this assignment in case of Anderson's graph is, it says that for every pointy z of x, in this case z is p, so we say p will include the pointies of y. So p points to q originally, we will now include the pointy of y, which is a, in the pointy set of p. So this is again an inclusion based algorithm. How would Steen's Gauss graph look like? Steen's Gauss graph will say I want to unify q and a, because q is the pointy of y and a is the pointy of y and q is the pointy of z. In this case z is p, so q is the pointy of x, so we'll unify q and a. So we unify q and a, and then we unify r and b, and then this unified node points to c. So this is the standard flow insensitive points to analysis. There are lots of variations of these algorithms, hundreds of variations of these algorithms, but most of them derive from these two basic standard flow insensitive analyses. We are not going to look at lots of variations. We want to just look at the basics.